Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Pine Grove campus of Spry Church. We are glad that you're here to worship with us this morning. Special welcome to any guests in the room and to our online worshipers as well. Here at Spry Church, we love Jesus, we seek transformation, and we are here to declare hope. And so you're invited to be a part of what God is doing here in a few significant ways. This morning, we just want to lift up a few of those ways and some other things that are happening in the life of our congregation before we get to our time of worship. First and foremost, I'm going to start with the same two questions I started with last week. Number one, do you like to get up early? And number two, do you like to shovel snow? Because if those two things are true about you, we would invite you to be our snow shoveler this winter. Although it is 60 degrees outside today, for some reason, we are anticipating some snow this winter, and we always need people to clear our walks on Sunday morning only so that people can get in and out of our church. And so if you say yes to both of those questions, we would invite you to consider being our volunteer to clear our front and back walks on Sunday mornings this winter. If that sounds appealing to you, please talk to myself or contact our church office, who will get you in touch with the trustees, but we are looking for a volunteer for that. The only other thing to talk about this morning is our Christmas Eve worship schedule, because Christmas Eve is upon us. It is just a week from today. And so here's what things are going to look like. We're going to do one service in the morning that is 10 a.m. That is a lessons and carols service, so it's a little shorter, a little bit more informal. And that is readings that'll take us through the Gospel of Luke and the birth story of Jesus with responsive hymns. And then in the evening, we'll be doing our full candlelight Christmas Eve services. And so those services are going to be at 5 p.m. and 7 p.m. 5 p.m. will be led by our wonderful band. 7 p.m. will be led by the organ and the piano and the traditional hymns, so please plan accordingly. And we invite you to invite your friends, invite your neighbors to those worship celebrations, because we are really excited to just tell the story of Jesus that evening. We're also looking for volunteers. Out on the Connection Center, there are some sign-up sheets, and we would invite you to sign up for greeting, being ushers, helping with the Christ candle, helping collect the offering that night, those kinds of things. And so if you would be willing, we invite you to volunteer either at the service you're attending or to serve one, stay one. So serve at the opposite service and come and worship at the other one. But those sign-up sheets are out on the Connection Center, and we would invite you to take part in those ways. So those are all of our announcements for today. So I'm going to invite you to stand. And today here on this last Sunday of Advent, we continue our season of waiting for God's arrival. We know that he has come once in Jesus, that he lived, died, rose again for our sake, and now we wait his return and the full ushering in of the kingdom. And so let's continue to sing of that good news today.
Jesus Christ is born.
you pray with me? Heavenly Father, as we come into your presence today to worship, we pray that you would once again empower us to be a people who go tell it on the mountain and everywhere that Jesus has been born to us. And not only, Lord, has he come to us to be our Savior, our Redeemer, our example, our way, our friend, but he has come to be our King. And so, Lord, as we ponder the questions of Christmas, we ask that you would once again impress upon our hearts that he is King, he is Lord over our lives, and that we might submit ourselves in all that we do to him. Allow us to worship you in spirit and in truth in the times ahead. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
we invite you to continue our time of worship together. Kids 6th grade and under are welcome to go downstairs for the kids' activities at this time.
Good morning. Today we are celebrating the 4th week of Advent, where we will be lighting the candle of love as we seek to follow the greatest commandment, to love God and love others. Our responsive reading this morning is based on Isaiah 61, 1 through 11, and Luke 1, 46 through 47. People of God, rejoice! Jesus Christ, the Anointed One of God, is sent to bring good news to the press, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners.
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
He has come to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and give them garland instead of ashes, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit.
My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior.
His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in their thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. Under his rule, the ancient ruins will be built up, former devastations raised again, and ruined cities restored. He will repair the devastations of many generations.
Let us pray. God of love, during this special season, we light again the first 3 Advent candles, the candles of hope, peace, and joy. As we light the 4th candle, the candle of love, fill our hearts with your love. Make us signs of your extravagant love for the whole world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God? Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The dumb will speak, the Lord will speak the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is the great I am.
Good morning. Our scripture lesson for today is found in the New Testament, the Gospel of Luke, Luke 1, 39 through 56. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord will fulfill his promises to her." And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, here on this fourth Sunday of our Advent celebration, Lord, we lit the candle of love. And Lord, I pray in the time ahead that we would be able to experience your word to us as an act of love toward us, that we would experience your word and its story as a love letter to each and every one of us, God, for you sent Jesus into the world in this way, that he might demonstrate your love for us, that he might live and die and be raised because of your love for us, that we might be reconciled to you. And so, Lord, in the time ahead, we pray that you once again open our eyes and ears and hearts to what you have to say to us. May we hear your love, and may we be brought closer to you by your power, by your Holy Spirit. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So I don't know if any of you have picked up on this, if you looked in your bulletins and saw the notes page, or maybe you're looking at the screen right now, but today's message has a little bit of a unique title, and I'll just read it for those of you who haven't checked it out yet. It is no, yes, 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 no, 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 yes, no, 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 yes, yes, no, no. How many of you have ever seen a title of a sermon look like that before? Probably not many of us, right? Some of you probably know where this is headed already, and you can kind of see where we're going to go, especially given the song that we just sang. But the reason that this is the title of this week's message is because all throughout this series, we have been talking about the songs of Christmas, and particularly the songs that we find in the first couple of chapters of the Gospel of Luke. But we've talked each week kind of about different Christmas songs that we hear and that we sing and that we experience each and every year in church and out of church as kind of a way of framing our particular sermon series for this Advent. And if you look at those words, the no's and the yeses, they are answers to questions that are posed inside of a Christmas song. What Christmas song might that be? It's the one we just sang, right? Mary, did you know? And Troy has done a great job in both services of singing that song for us. And so, yeah, these are the answers. If you write down the individual questions that are found in the song, Mary, did you know? These are the actual questions, or the actual answers, rather, as far as we can tell, to the questions that are posed there. So, for example, Mary, did you know that one day this child would walk on water? Probably not, right? That's the opening line of the song. She probably didn't know that Jesus was going to do exactly that. But, Mary, did you know that this child would one day save our sons and daughters? The answer is yes, right? Yes, she did. Actually, if you go back to the conversation she has with the angel Gabriel, Joseph has a very similar conversation. He says, you're going to name this child Jesus because he will save people from their sins. And Jesus actually means God saves or God delivers. Another question that is posed, did she know that one day this child would calm the storm with his hand? Again, probably not, right? That she didn't know that Jesus would do specifically that. But the other question that is asked is, did you know that this child would one day rule the nations? And the answer to that question is yes, right? So we go back to that conversation with the angel, and the angel tells Mary that he will one day reign over Jacob's descendants forever, and his kingdom will never end. And so it's kind of a fun activity, at least I think it's fun, to go through each of the questions that are posed there in the song, Mary, Did You Know? Because so many of us know it so well, we hear it so often around Christmas time, and actually go through and biblically try to give our best answer to the questions that are posed there. What did Mary actually know? Now, the reason I start by talking about that today is not only because we just sang it, but because beyond kind of our familiarity with this song, there's actually something that kind of lies underneath the surface of Mary, Did You Know? And that is controversy. Did any of you know this? That the song Mary, Did You Know? Is actually quite controversial. And I think it's probably sprung up more in the last decade or two. But if you talk to people, there are some people who have very strong opinions about this song. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody completely clueless as to what I'm talking about? So I'll talk about it a little bit. If you think about the song itself, right, it kind of depends upon you how you ask the questions in the song. But if you ask them in a certain way, it can kind of come across as or assume that Mary is kind of clueless in this whole thing, right? So if you ask them in the certain posture of like, Mary, we know a lot of things about Jesus, right? Because we live on the other side of his life, death, and resurrection. We read the gospel. So Mary, we know a lot of things about Jesus that you probably didn't know. And there's a certain aspect of that that is true. But it can kind of make Mary look like she doesn't know anything at all, right? She kind of comes off as a babe in the woods. It was just all this stuff is happening to her and happening around her, but she herself is clueless and she just happens to be having God's baby. This is very true amongst like certain people, especially some people that are like maybe more theology nerds or certain pastors. They kind of have an axe to grind against this particular song. I can tell you more than 50% of my graduating seminary class was female. A lot of women have a problem with how Mary can be kind of painted through this song. So I can tell you that most of that 50% plus are not singing this song in their churches during Advent. Just to give you an example of how strong some people can feel about this, here's a quote from a Baptist theologian who says, "It is the most sexist Christmas song ever written. It treats her like a clueless child. Could you imagine a song asking Abraham 17 times if he knew he'd be the father of a great nation?" So some people have a problem with this particular song. And like I said, they can have strong opinions about it. Now, obviously, the point of the song, Mary, Did You Know?, is not to create an airtight theological exposition of what Mary did or did not know about the incarnation of Jesus, right? That is not the point of the song. The point of the song is to help us reflect on the full story of Jesus' life in light of what happens at Christmas time. And so if we're charitable, right, to the song, and we actually read what the original writer of the song intended for it, because you can go and read his opinions as well, what we see is that this song was not intended to be in any way insulting to Mary or what she may or may not have known about Jesus, but instead was to help us reflect on Jesus himself. But the interesting thing about that is that it points to kind of a larger conversation about Mary that some of us might be familiar with. And that is that Mary is a controversial figure. Those of you that grew up in Roman Catholicism know this very well, or maybe are familiar with Roman Catholicism, right? Because there are different beliefs in the Roman Catholic Church than what we have in the Protestant Church about Mary. And when Mary shows up in the scripture, it's almost always in some kind of controversial fashion, right? So we have in the Christmas story the virgin birth, which throughout Christian history has generated a lot of controversy. There are a lot of people who have problems with the idea that a virgin can have a child by God's power. I think it's kind of crucial. I think it's pretty darn important, right? But at the same time, some people have a hard time with that idea. There are those beliefs in the Roman Catholic Church, like I said, that we won't have time to get into today. But if you think about where else Mary shows up, she shows up looking like not a great parent when they lose Jesus at the temple, right? And when Jesus is 12 in that story that we hear. She shows up at Jesus' first miracle at the wedding in Cana of Galilee as well and says, "Jesus, the party needs to continue to go on and we're out of wine. Can you do something about this?" And Jesus responds to her and says, "Woman, my time is not yet." Saying, like, "I really probably shouldn't do this," right? But he does it anyway because it's his mom and he loves his mom. The next story we hear is Jesus when he's got this big group of people around him teaching at home or at someone's home, and Jesus' mother and brothers show up and they ask, "Jesus, we need you to come outside so we can talk to you. You're going a little bit far with this whole Messiah thing. Like, we need to have a conversation." And Jesus says, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And he kind of reframes, right, this whole idea of family and who his mother actually is. And he says, "Those who do the will of my father are my mother and my brothers and my sisters." And then the last place we see Mary is actually at the cross. When she's watching Jesus be crucified and he looks at her and he looks at John and he says, "John, take care of her. This is your mother now." Right? And so wherever Mary shows up in the story, there's always a little bit of controversy. There's always a little bit of just some good questions that kind of rise to the top. And she, if you think about it, is one of the only figures from the Christmas story that actually shows up throughout Jesus' life. So if you think about the people that we've been talking about, so Elizabeth, Zechariah, Joseph, who we haven't talked much about this year, but those other prominent figures, they're there at Jesus' birth, and then they disappear from the gospel story, don't they? We don't see them again. And yet Mary is present there from birth all the way up through the cross. And so she has an extremely important role to play in Jesus' life, which puts her at the center of some very important questions. And a little bit later in the service, we're going to look at one of those particular questions and talk about it. But before we get there, we have to talk about this song that she sings in the Gospel of Luke that Peggy read for us a couple of minutes ago. So let me just set the stage a little bit. Most of us are familiar with this story. This is the quintessential Christmas story, right? Where the angel shows up to Mary and tells her that she is going to conceive a child even though she is a virgin, that she's going to be pregnant. This is the same angel, Gabriel, that shows up to Zechariah and shows up to Joseph, So Gabriel was very busy in those days. His planner was very full. And so he goes from one to the other to the other. And finally, Mary finds out this plan. And this is what the angel says to her. He says, "You will conceive and give birth to a son. You are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." And so Mary is told straight away what's happening. She's told straight away that the Messiah is coming into the world, and not only are you going to give birth to the Messiah, the one who will be the king of Israel, but you are actually giving birth to the Son of God. And so God's Holy Spirit is going to come to you, and you're going to be pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit, even though you are a virgin. She's also told in this conversation that her cousin, we think it's her cousin, Elizabeth, is pregnant with John. And we've talked about Elizabeth and Zechariah the last couple of weeks, and so most of us are familiar with those two. But she finds out that Elizabeth is about 6 months pregnant with John. And so when Mary receives this news and she ends up pregnant, her first action is to run to her cousin Elizabeth and to talk about what God is doing in their midst. And so as Luke kind of kicks off the story that gives us Mary's song, which we'll talk about in just a moment, this is where we find her. It says, "At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth." Now, the word hurried here in the Greek language means to go somewhere with enthusiasm. So as she goes, she's excited. She's joyful, right? She can't wait to share the news of what has happened to her and that she's pregnant. And she is there and she's excited to share in Elizabeth's pregnancy as well. And so she kind of bounds her way to Elizabeth's house. And so as she gets there, this is what happens. We read, "When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb." So this is John, right, in Elizabeth's womb. And when she hears Mary's greeting, John leaps, because he recognizes already, right, that she is the mother of this one for whom he is the forerunner. And so, it says, "Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry to Mary, 'Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me that the mother of my Lord comes to me?'" She's humbled in this moment. She says, "For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she, who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord." So this is what Elizabeth says to Mary. And at the conclusion of those words, Mary begins to speak. And this is where we get her song in Luke's gospel. Now, this song is known as the Magnificat in Latin, because that is the word for magnifies. And her first words in the song are, "My soul magnifies." So this is how we know this song. So listen, just listen to what she says. She says, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And so she lifts her voice in this, what is a really a beautiful song of praise and adoration and joy and excitement, right? This is the posture that she has in this song. She's thrilled with what God is doing. Think about yourself, right? Maybe on Easter morning here when we sing Graves into Gardens, you know, and Mullen and Rebecca really let it fly, right? And how fun that is and joyful that is, and we pound on the pews and we sing that song. Think about that times like 1,000. And that's where Mary is in this particular moment. And so it's easy for us to see her joy. It's easy for us to see her excitement. But what's not as easy for us to see is kind of where she gets these words from. Because these words are her own, right? She owns them. She speaks them. But these words don't actually come from her initially or originally. Because as you look at what she says in these words, what we find is that almost every single one of them, almost every word that she speaks is an allusion, with an A, I, not an I, right, allusion, or a phrase or a word or is vocabulary that actually comes from the Old Testament. Every word that she speaks is somehow taken from a book from the Hebrew Scriptures. This is like a Bible nerd's dream when you read through Mary's words. Does anybody have a Bible with like cross references in it, where it's like at the bottom of the page, it's got things listed, right? If your Bible were to list every single cross reference or allusion in Mary's song, it would take up like 20 pages. Like it is a lot. I'll show you in just a moment. But just to give you a couple of examples, right? She says, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." You look at something like Psalm 103, right? And she clearly reflects the language of the Psalms. She says, "Praise the Lord, my soul, all my inmost being praises his holy name." And when she says here, "My soul glorifies or magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices," your soul and your spirit in Hebrew thought was the center of your being. So your soul wasn't in your brain or in your heart, right? Your soul or your spirit was the deepest part of you. And so she's reflecting what Psalm 103 says here, right? "All my inmost being praises your holy name." We go on. She says, "For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant." If you look at Psalm 8, right, David asks the questions. He says, "What is man that you would be mindful of him?" Here is Mary saying, "God is mindful of me." So we get another one of those cross references. Another one says this: "He has performed mighty deeds with his arm." God's arm all throughout the Old Testament is a sign of strength that we see relates all the way back to the Exodus. So Psalm 89:10, for example, says, "With your strong arm you scattered your enemies." And we could go on and on like this for quite a while. There are strong overtones of the song, or rather of the story of 1 Samuel and the story of Hannah. There are tons of references to the Psalms and the Proverbs. And actually, this week as I was researching this message, I came across a chart that has probably not all, but a lot of these cross-references listed. And this is just a sampling of them. This is probably maybe half of all the things that you could trace from the Hebrew Scriptures into different words and phrases and vocabulary from Mary's song. Again, this is like last week. Don't try to write all those down. If you want them, take a picture or I'll send them to you. But the point is that there's a lot, right? And so what Mary is doing is that she is pulling words and phrases and vocabulary from the Hebrew Scriptures to express herself and express what God is doing for her and in her and around her in this particular moment. She creates this beautiful poem that's just filled with all of this wonderful language from the Old Testament. But this is the interesting thing about this particular song and about her doing this, because this is another point of controversy around Mary. And you might not know this, but one question that you could ask is, how did Mary, knowing what we know about Mary, pull all this together? Now it doesn't we don't necessarily mean that she, you know, explicitly was like, in that moment, "I'm going to reference Micah 7:20, or I'm going to reference Psalm 107, right? But what she was doing was she was clearly using language she was familiar with, language she had heard, language that described people's relationships with God and making it her own. But people have asked the question, and especially the last 200 years, where liberal scholars have said, there is no way that someone like Mary could utter words like this, could put together a poem like this. And the words are too lofty, it's too well-crafted, it's too complex. There's nobody like Mary that could actually do this. Remember, Mary was between like 14 and 16 years old. She was illiterate, she was poor, she was uneducated. And so they look at it from the human perspective, and they say, there is no way that these are her words. Luke, the gospel writer, wrote this and then put these words in her mouth, because there's no way that she could do this. Which is an interesting question to ask, which maybe has some logic to it, like I said, from kind of just a purely human perspective. If you ask the average person in our culture who was poor and illiterate to just come up with a poem, they're generally not going to write Shakespeare, right? And so they just kind of dismiss it offhand that this could possibly be the words of Mary. But as I was reading this week and I was doing research, I was reminded of an experience that I had one time in the country of Haiti. Some of you have been to Haiti. Some of you know a little bit about that country. In my old job, what I used to do is I would travel around and take people who were donors to the organization that I worked for to the countries where we worked to see the work that was happening. And what we would do is the organization that I worked for and that Becky works for now, they work inside the local church in developing countries to gather people together to save money and then also teach them about the gospel, to try to empower people who live in poverty to just have a better economic future. But if you look at who is in these groups, right, they are mostly women who, in Haiti in particular, are people in poverty, right, making less than like $1.25 per day. In Haiti, you've got about a 50-50 shot of being illiterate, so most of them, especially being poor, can't read. And in addition to that, the highest level of education that most people in Haiti receive is about a third grade education. And so these are people, right, who are in poverty, who are uneducated, who look a lot like Mary did. And during these group lessons, what they would do is each member would kind of go on a rotating basis to share a different devotional moment with the group. And so I was visiting this one group. I remember it was on my birthday. I turned 30 years old in Haiti. It was great. And then I ate birthday cake in Haiti, and I got sick and ended up in the hospital. So don't eat the cake. But I was visiting this one group, and this woman, it was her turn to share with the group, kind of a devotional moment. And so she got up, and this was through Creole, right? So they were speaking Creole, not English, so I was listening to this through a translator. She stood up, and she said to her group, she said, "Jesus says, 'Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Who are you answering the door for?'" And she proceeded to go on about a 5-minute mini sermon asking the group members of her group who they were answering the door for. And she said, "Are you answering the door for your bad habits? Are you answering the door for laziness and not going to work and doing what you had said you would do? Are you answering the door for your bad ex-boyfriends?" I remember that particular that particular illustration very well. But she said, "Your door is closed, and Jesus stands there and knocks, and you're out here answering the door for all of these other things that are leading you away from Jesus, but here is Jesus knocking, let him in." And then she sat back down, and I went, dang. And so here I was, right, watching this barely educated woman who probably could not read the Bible on her own, at least not very much of it, who was a person who was poor, giving this beautiful message to her peers that was rooted in Scripture, filled with the Holy Spirit, giving these just encouraging words to them to be better followers of Jesus in a way that was probably better than most sermons that most pastors preach on Sundays, myself included. And so this week when I read, well, scholars doubt that Mary could have said these things herself because, well, it's just far too advanced and far too complex, and there's nobody that could know the Scriptures that well. I said, I don't think so, because I've seen it, because I thought about that woman in Haiti who looks a lot like Mary, and I said, you know what? She could do it in a much less kind of advanced culture orally, right? So oral tradition and stories that were passed down through kind of verbal means were much more important in Mary's day. If this woman can do it, I guarantee you, especially under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, Mary could do it. And so as I was reading that, right, and thinking about that particular experience, I said, Mary's 100% capable of coming up with these words on her own. But not only that, but what Mary shows us here is consistent with what the Scriptures show us about how God works. And the Christmas story shows us this over and over and over again. And what Mary shows us and what Christmas shows us is this, that over and over again, God favors humble people who trust in his word. Right? Think about the Christmas story. Everybody remember Zechariah from a couple weeks ago? So Zechariah, right, he's the priest. He's the one who knows the Bible. He's standing in the temple. And when he gets a message from God, his response is, according to who? Or who says? And then he gets to play the silent game for 9 months. He was really good at it. But he's the one that should be responding in faith, right? He knows, he's the one that should know the Bible. But then we get pictures of Elizabeth and Joseph, and then today Mary, who, when God speaks to them, they trust. And they have a front row seat to what God is doing. And when they enter into that story, they demonstrate joy and excitement. They demonstrate praise and adoration. And in Mary's case, right, we see her respond in amazing, tremendous ways with great faith. And she's able to accept and lean into God's plan for her life because, precisely because, she has a clear knowledge of and trust in God's word to her in the scriptures. She trusts in his character and can trust in his plan because she knows him and she knows his word. Like the woman in Haiti that I saw, and probably to a much greater degree, she knew God's character and she knew God's word. And so when it came time for her to respond to what God was doing, she had the words right there because she knows her scriptures. If you think about the book of Proverbs, right, it says, God mocks the proud but shows favor to the humble and the oppressed. So again, those who humble themselves before God and willingly submit themselves to him are the ones whom God favors. Now, that word favor can be dangerous. I'll just say this really quickly, because favor in our culture has come to mean health and wealth and prosperity, and you get everything that you've always wanted. And being Jesus' mother and having God's favor, as Mary would find out, was a mixed bag, was it not? She is called blessed from generation to generation. Here we are 2,000 years later, right, talking about her, this blessing that God gave her. She got to have this front row seat and this integral part into what God was doing to bring Jesus into the world, but yet we also look at the end of Jesus' life and she has to watch her son be crucified. And there was pain along the way, right, as Jesus grew into his role as the Messiah. And so, favor does not always mean we get everything that we want, but what it does mean is that for her and for us, our best place to experience God's goodness and God's blessing and God using you to bless the world around you and lead others to Jesus is to be people of humility who trust and obey God's word. To present ourselves every single day, not with our own agendas, to present ourselves every single day, not with our own wants and desires and needs and say, here, God, take care of this for me, but to every day in humility submit ourselves to God's will, God's leading, and God's word. To obey and love and serve as he directs. Mary even says this directly at one point when she's talking to the angel. She says, I am the Lord's servant. May your word to me, which is God's word to her, be fulfilled. And so we see in Mary this readiness to trust in humility, what God is saying. So the question is for you and me, right? What does this look like for us? How would my life at work, at home, how would my parenting be different if I approached every day with this attitude? If I was humble in front of God and followed his commands? How would my commitments be different? How would my habits be different? Right? If we adopted the posture of Mary and lived lives of humility and acceptance of God's word, right? How would my day-to-day look different? If I trusted in God's instruction, if I trusted in God's story, if I trusted in God's plan above everything else, especially myself. Because when I read the story about Mary and I experienced what I experienced with that woman in Haiti, I am humbled because I know that I have a long way to go to be this every single day. But we know that we are to seek to be people of trusting humility, to obey, to love, to serve in this posture, knowing that if we do, God will be able to use us to do great things for the world around us, to love well, and that if we do that, in God's eyes, maybe not in the world's eyes, maybe not from generation to generation, people will know us 2,000 years from now, but I know that in God's eyes, just like Mary, we will be called blessed. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that today, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that we would be like Christ, who gave us the perfect example of humility and submission to you, who lived every single day serving others, loving others, and only being about your will. And as we seek to be more like him, Lord, we look to someone like Mary, who did this so well, who knew your word and knew your plan so well that when she needed words to talk about how she was feeling and what was happening, Lord, she drew on the scriptures. But she did so, Lord, out of a place of humility and love, knowing, Lord, that if she humbled herself to that story and to what you were doing, that you would do great things in and through her, and you did. And so, God, help us to be more like that, to serve with Christ-like love and humility. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit to do this and do this well each and every day, Lord, that we might carry this posture into our work, into our families, into our entire lives, that we might be known as a people who serve and love well in humility to our God. And so, Lord, we pray all of these things, submitting them to you and your care, and now praying that prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we move forward in our worship, I just want to share something that has been going on in our congregation. Here at Spry Church, we talk about being relentlessly devoted to the mission of God. And during this season of Advent, we've invited you to participate in that mission in one specific way, and that is through our Joy in Serving. So Joy in Serving is our opportunity every year to just kind of go above and beyond in our giving and our service to our community around us. And so we've had a few different things that we've done, that you've done over the past few weeks, where you've been able to participate. So I just wanted to give a quick update on some of that. First and foremost, the night that we decorated here for Christmas, we also gathered over in the fellowship hall to pack bags of essential supplies for The Well, which is the West End Local Link, which is a partner of ours. Across the two campuses, we put together more than 100 bags of essential supplies for people here, and we took them and delivered them last week. And this picture is of Jen, our office administrator, with two of the volunteers from The Well receiving the giant mountain of essential supplies that have gone to serve our neighbors in need. And remarkably, the workers at The Well were so overwhelmed by your generosity and by this giving that they actually were brought to tears, seeing just the sheer volume of things that you gave as a congregation. In addition to this, we also were doing the Angel Tree this year. We served more than 100 families through the Angel Tree. We also took another step forward in getting to know the families that come to our food bank, our food pantry, and kind of had conversations with them around what some of their needs are in this holiday season. So we were able to provide 50 gifts for our food bank families in addition to the Angel Tree families. And then lastly, through our Women of Worth group, we provided supplies and gifts this year for 7 single moms in our community as well. So there's just a lot to celebrate and a lot to be thankful for. It's all because of you and your generosity, you participating in God's mission here at Spry. And so we want to say thank you and glory to God for the way he's moved in our congregation throughout this Christmas season. This morning, we've got one more opportunity, actually, to be a part of this mission. So after service, you're invited to come out just to the lobby here. And what we'll be doing is we're going to be writing handwritten cards to drop off to some of our direct neighbors here around the Pine Grove campus, inviting them to our Christmas Eve services. So there is a card there, a pen there, even a little script to use as well. So you don't have to think of your own invitation. You can just use that. But we would invite as many of you that can stay to please stay to write those handwritten cards so that anybody around our church who is not already connected to a church can come and hear the good news of Jesus at Christmas Eve and hopefully get to know all of you as well. I will just throw this out there, not that it's a competition, but the first service wrote 47 cards. If you could do more, that would be awesome. There will also be a group that is going out this week to deliver those and knock on some doors and hang them on doors. If you would like to be a part of that group that's going to be happening Tuesday night, please come see me, and I will connect you with them and to have you be a part of that team as well. But we want to reach out to our neighbors in that specific way as we get ready for Christmas Eve today. That's all we have for kind of our update on Joy in Serving. Thank you once again. Glory to God once again for all that he's done through each of you. I'm going to invite you to stand as we once again say the words of the Apostles' Creed. And so this is the great story of what God has given us, kind of in Cliff's Notes fashion. And so I invite you once again, church, to say what it is you believe. I believe in God.
you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days have been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him, Christ the
And so this week, may you go in peace and live by faith, and may you be a person like Mary who, in humility and surrender, follows what God asks you to do through his word in trust. A couple of reminders. First of all, if you'd like to write some cards, please come to the lobby. There are also on the Connection Center opportunities to sign up to serve on the Christmas Eve services. And lastly, I would just invite you to take this week to prepare your hearts well for our celebration of Christmas Eve a week from today. Read maybe through the stories of the Gospel of Luke and the Gospel of Matthew and what John says about the Incarnation. Take some time this week to really think about the week ahead as we prepare to celebrate. This is one of the best times of year for God to remind you of the significance of the good news he offers to us. And so I would invite you to not let that week go by unnoticed, but prepare your hearts well as we get ready to worship and celebrate the coming of Jesus a week from today. Have a great week.